sorts of ways to select it. This is your lasso tool, which is the next tool down. All right, and the lasso tool has a couple of different things. There's the lasso tool, the polygon lasso tool, and the magnetic lasso tool. All right, and the polygon, well, let me show you the lasso tool. The lasso tool is basically how to select, you know, a sort of ridiculously complex shape just by drawing the selection, okay? So now, if I were to use the brush tool, you ever just draw a blank?
Yes.
Brush tool, somebody tell me.
The tool.
Right. So again, it's only affecting what's in the selection, right? But that's a really hard to use tool, to use it really well. Usually that's for like if I just want to pick something out of a group of objects that already has a fairly clean background. Right? Better than the lasso tool would be here is, if you go down one more tool, is this combo of the quick selection tool and or the magic wand tool. All right? Let's start with the quick select tool. And the quick select tool, the brush-based tool, it's a smart tool that allows you to select parts of an image based on what you're painting over. Okay, so let's just use it and we'll figure it out. Okay, so when you start using the quick selection tool, like you'll see that it's basically a brush and you can change the size of the brush because it's brush based. And you'll see a little X in the middle. Right, or a plus in the middle. And that's indicating that when you use the tool, it's going to add to your selection. Okay, and if you make a selection by clicking on something, I've selected, I'm going to undo that. I'm going to come over here and paint this, and it's going to sort of automatically realize what I'm trying to grab, right? Because it's smart. And I'll keep adding to that selection. In areas of high contrast, it's going to want to sort of rethink things for you. So you probably didn't want that, but then you're like, yeah, I actually did. You know. So then you just kind of keep selecting. In images that have really clear-cut backgrounds, it's usually pretty simple. And then it kind of smooths it out for you. Alright, so this is going to be one of your go-to tools for creating cutouts. If you have a bunch of stuff selected, if you hold the Option key down, it will remove from your selection. It changes to the minus, and it will remove from your selection. Okay, but what we do is we want all that stuff. So what you've done is you've created this really cool selection of this martini glass really super quickly rather than going through and doing that with your lasso tool. Okay, the way you would do that with your lasso tool or even your magnetic lasso tool is that you would just kind of move along and keep drawing that line. Okay? But the new tool makes that super easy to do. Alright? After you've used your quick select tool, there's this little guy up at the top that you should default to that's called Refine Edge. Right? And that is just an incredibly helpful little widget. When you hit Refine Edge with your selection,
Refine Edge.
Let me show you. When you have something selected, it's this button up here at the top. Now, if you don't have it, it should be also under Select, Refine Edge. All right? So if you hit the Refine Edge thing and you have your martini reasonably cut out, you want to go through this whole dialog box, right? The first thing is your preview mode, right? And you have all these different options. So like if you do it on an overlay, the pink mask just shows you what you don't have selected. Okay? And that's kind of a good place to start. It gives you a clear indication of your selection. selection. If you missed something, like if I'm, it's also active, it would show up in there, right? Like if I accidentally not selected that and went to refine edge and went back to my overlay, you can see that that would be selected. So, but I want it selected. So again, if you have that selected, that's like your first thing to make sure that your selection is cool. You can add smart edge detection to it, which just, in this case, it's a really smooth image, but we don't really need to mess with that in this case. You also have the option to smooth your selection. Sometimes if you have a jagged selection, smoothing will help. You have the ability to feather your selection, which is to soften the edge, soften the selection. And then you also have the ability to shift your edge for the selection. It's not really going to show up much here, but in or out. Okay. You see how if I shift the edge out, I get this little white halo on the outside of the image. Right. Sometimes that's helpful, usually moving in the opposite direction when you want to create a cool graph. Okay, so that's adjusting the edge. Now, the maybe the most important aspect of this is to decide what your output is. So this is your selection, but what's your output going to be? And here, you can do a layer mask, a new layer with mask, a new document, so on and so forth. Most of the time, I find it most useful to go with a new layer. All right? Once I have that set, I hit OK. And now I have a layer, created a new layer for me that's void of the white background.
That's cool.
Okay? So it doesn't have to be a white background when you're doing this, but it's just incredibly helpful. All right? We're kind of skipping a little bit ahead to creating cutouts, but I think that's okay. Selecting and creating cutouts are kind of one and the same. All right, so there's another way of getting to the same point without even using your quick select tool. All right? Let me show you how to do that. I'm going to turn off this layer and go back to this layer and select. Okay, so if we're looking at this image, what do we notice about the background?
It's white.
It's white. It's because somebody's already cut it out. A professional photographer's already cut it out. Now, there may be a need for you to actually remove the white background, so let's just focus on that. If you're making a cutout, like if you're going to montage this with another image, and you need to get rid of this white background, what do we know? Well, let me show you. If you go to Window, Info, this is kind of a useful little widget. You get this little guy up here. All right. And what this does is it shows you the information for where your cursor is. Okay, so it shows you your position of the cursor. And it shows you the RGB values of what your cursor is over. And the CMYK value is so fun. As I'm over the background, nothing is registered. You see it's all zeros. But as I move on to the image, you're seeing all the CMYK and RGB values of every little chase. Okay. Now look at the inside of martini glass. Okay. Okay, so on the inside of the martini glass, you can see that now it looks reasonably consistent over here, but as I get it into the shadow regions, I start picking up more and more little bits of color, these 1 or 2 or 3 or 8 or 10% right? But if I go into the background, you can see that that is solid white, and that is no variation in the pixel information, the color, right? So, now that we know that, there's going to be a faster way that we can select this martini glass, even faster than using the quick select. All right. that's using the thing underneath the quick select tool, which is the magic wand.
Yeah.
All right. The magic wand tool is an old Photoshop tool, and it's really, as far as I'm concerned, only useful in this situation, right? So if we select a martini glass with the magic wand tool, what do we get?
The marching ants.
We get the marching ants over a small selection.
Right.
Okay, that's not what we were looking for, right?
Right.
That's because if you look at the contextual menu for this, the number we're concerned about is the tolerance, okay? That's sort of the color range. That's a number that needs to be between 0 and 255, I believe. Okay? If you set this at 0 and deselect this and try again, you're only going to get those pixels that are exactly the same in terms of pixel numbers. Those are the pixels that are exactly the same color. Okay? And as we get into areas with greater differentiations in shade, those clusters are going to be even smaller. Okay, we set that tolerance number to 255. I don't know why 255 is the number. And click here. It selects the whole image, everything. Okay, because 255 is the maximum range, so it's going to select everything. So the key to using the magic wand tool is getting that tolerance. So, but what's going to be the easiest way of selecting this martini glass? Using the magic wand. Knowing what we know. Anyone? Come on, puzzle solvers out there.
Draw over.
No. Okay, we know that the background is universally pure white. So let's just use the magic wand tool to select the background instead of the foreground. Okay, so we're going to go to our magic wand tool, we're going to set the tolerances to 0, or maybe 2 or 3 just in case there are a few random pixels. And then we're going to click on the background. Alright, so what have we selected?
The background.
No, we haven't selected
just
that.
Just the back.
So if we go to a refine edge and look at the preview, the pink is what we haven't selected. The white is what we have selected.
Sweet.
Right? So, but we don't want that selection. That's not the selection we want. We want the opposite of that selection. Right?
Yeah. Yes.
Under the select menu, there's the handy little option to inverse your selection.
I can't inverse.
Do you have anything selected?
No.
Okay. If you have your thing selected and inverse it, it just flips the selection. Okay? So, with the selection inverse, then you can go back to your refine edge and go through your whole step. Okay? So, you see how you can make, if your background is clear, you can make a cutout in seconds.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out how you're making the background red.
Okay, that's in your refine edge.
Okay.
It's just a preview. Historically speaking, and this is probably more context than you need, red film was used to indicate images of an area that you didn't want reproduced on camera. All right, so that's why they use the red as kind of a key or
Okay,
I'm going to cancel out of this so I have my margin. Select inverse.
Okay.
Select inverse.
Gotcha.
All right,
So for mine, there's a lot of jagged edges around my
Yeah, actually there is. That's a great question.
Right.
All right, so listen up, everyone. Rima asked, she said her selection was jagged. All right, so I'm going to deselect this, and I'm going to go back and Yeah, I get the same thing. I accidentally, you remember when I said I was gonna set my tolerance at 2 or 3?
Yeah.
I accidentally set it at 23. Okay? So what this is indicating is that there is more color variation. Does that even show up in there? Is this monitor burns hot? There's more color variation in the pixels between here and here. Okay? So in this case, what we want to do is make sure that our tolerance is set at a position that allows for a smooth selection. Okay, so at 15, we're still getting a few jaggies. I'm gonna hit 20, and that looks pretty smooth. All right, now the other thing that you wanna select here is probably anti-aliasing. Anti-aliasing makes for a smoother selection. It's kind of technical, but it basically kind of averages out some pixels. So again, once you have your background selected, you go to select inverse, and there's your selection. All right. Let me show you why this technique is really helpful. All right. So, granted, with this not selected, I could go in here with the quick select tool and boom, boom, boom. You know. No, maybe not that fast. But in just a few quick strokes, if I was really taking my time, this would be a lot better. I could get reasonably close to a good clean cutout. And again, that was just seconds, right? But normally I could get there a lot better if I were actually close. The reason why that technique of selecting the background is useful is in this instance. I want you to guys, if you haven't opened it yet, open the file wheel. Okay, so here you have a cutout image already of a wheel. But if you need to put that on top of a different background or something like that, if you need to do a complex selection, this is the technique you want to use. Rather than going through with your quick select tool and trying to select the rim and the spokes and figuring out everything, and then you get like all these bizarre selections, what you can do, that's when it's going to pay dividends, to go in with your magic wand and select that color, that background color, and then do a inverse selection. Now let me show you one more feature of the magic wand tool. So if I go to the refine edge, what I've selected is just a white background around here, but now the negative space is in there. Why is that, you ask? I'd be happy to explain. There is this little button up here that says contiguous. All right? If that's clicked, it will only select pixels in that tolerance range that are adjacent to one another. If you unclick contiguous and do that, then it's going to select all of the pixels in that range. We could probably drop it down.
Okay.
And try it again and see what we get there. Okay. Then your selection is going to be much more accurate.
That's cool.
Okay. And you know, you can go ahead and fix that mask too. But if you're creating, trying to create a complicated cutout that has sort of positive and negative shapes, the magic wand tool with an inverse selection is going to be the way to go. In fact, on your cheat sheet, I want you to write with the magic wand tool, write inverse selection, okay? Because that's going to be absolutely critical that you remember the inverse selection, because that's actually on the test. part of your test will be creating a clean cutout using whatever technique you find. So if you choose to use a magic wand tool, you know how to inverse the selection. Savannah.
Will you like do that one more time?
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right, so starting over from scratch, this is just a blank image, right? I'm going to go up here to the contextual menus. I'm going to set my tolerance. I'm going to set it even lower, so 5 maybe. For anti-alias, not contiguous. And then I'm going to just click on white. Okay? So that's my selection. Now when I go to refine, or before I go to refine edge, I go to select inverse. And then when I hit refine edge, I can see that my wheel, it's kind of hard to see here, but the image that isn't pink is what I have selected. Okay. Now I can keep continuing to clean this up before I go to the refine edge. Then I can go back to my quick select tool and make a nice little smaller brush and get rid of some of those highlights that are showing up in the selection. But listen, I know this is kind of rambling and how we've gone from like 0 to some relatively advanced techniques here in a short amount of time. The best way that you're going to learn this stuff is by playing with it. You know, playing and practicing and exploring. You know, cool. Right. So now, grab a refine edge, get a nice clear cutout, set that to new layer, hit OK. And now I have one of the most difficult things that is to cut out in Photoshop. Recommend you practice with this and you play it, because this is one of the hardest parts of the test. And I could keep going and going and going on this until it's driven home, but one, we don't have that much time tonight, and and you're really going to need to practice this on your own. I mean, there are plenty of great tutorials out there on how to create products, right? But the other thing that I want you to put down next to the quick select tool in your notes is the refine edge. Okay? Make sure that you're in include refine edge and inverse selection on your notes. Alright, the old way of doing a cutout. By the way, if anyone's interested, and sometimes it makes sense, is just going in with your eraser tool and erasing the background. Right? Sometimes that actually delivers reasonably good results, but I'll show you how you would do that. The first thing you would do in that case is copy a layer. To copy a layer, and we'll get into working on layers next week, but you can either right-click on it and say duplicate layer, that's probably the easiest way, and then turn off the background layer. So then you could go in here with your erasing tool and just start erasing, right? By the way, brush-based tools, if you click once and hold the shift key down and click again, it will draw a contiguous line. Sometimes that's helpful, sometimes it's not. Usually it's only helpful when you're dealing with straight lines. By the way, I want to talk to you guys just quickly about cutouts in general. Right? This is sort of why I had this image and the other image of the marquee brush. In fact, you remember when I showed you about workspaces and being able to arrange your documents? if I go two up vertical, I can have these documents side by side and make a really nice comparison. Right? So if you were going to use a cutout in a magazine article about martinis, assuming that the martini on the right actually wasn't just a glass but a martini, which one would you use and why? The light one?
The one on the right.
Just the one on the right? Why?
It's just one martini.
It's just one martini. I could go in here and create a cutout and eliminate all of the other martinis.
Yeah.
Right? Any other feedback on this?
Wait, your select tool. Again,
all right. This is if you guys use cutouts in your publications, this is kind of important. All right. Cutouts are an optical illusion. You know, it wants to look as though. I mean, the goal is to have the image look as though it's sort of on the paper, you know, not in an actual setting. Okay, so anything that alters that illusion deems the image inappropriate for using the cutout, right? So here we have this image. You could cut it out, and basically it's already cut out. You put it on a page, and it looks really nice there. It's like it belongs there, all right? If I were to cut out this foreground martini here, right? The problem with that is if you look through the glass, and this is especially important with glass, it's going to have all of that context of its surroundings with it. It's going to have the refracted image of the background, the sky, the trees, and everything like that. And so when you try to run it as like the drink of the month, especially in a magazine, in the cutout, it's not going to look right. All right. So whenever possible, if you have control over the photography, if you're shooting for a cutout, shoot it on a white background, you know, so that it'll reproduce well. Unless you're going to reproduce it on a colored background. That sort of brings us to the end of where we want to be for class tonight. We've got 25 minutes left of class, so I'm perfectly happy to let you guys go. However, anyone wants to stay behind for that period of time to go over? Savannah, anything that you may have eluded you, I'd be happy to stick around and go over.
I just need just that.
Anything on
I mean, it's recorded, so.
Okay.
Yeah. I just want to. I know, I sent it to you later, though. Basically, let's do this. Let's go here. Okay, let's go here. Let's see.
Yeah, I just want to know how far you are.
Okay. Basically, let's go here. Let's delete this one. Just delete this one. Yes, I want to delete the background. So basically, you can always go right here and you could you want to duplicate layer. Just put background copy. And then basically, you can turn this one off. And then with the erasing right here, you can start erasing.
It's the other one. That's why.
Yep.
That's it. I got it.
Savannah. What's your number? So like
my phone number?
Yeah, I'm gonna send you these videos.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, just write it down right here. Just write it down right here. And some of my videos are cut off because it's still a little
bit.
No problem.
What's your name?
Cece. Just put Cece.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cece.
I gave up. I'm calling myself by my real name now.
Hey.
Okay. But yeah, I will send it out to you tonight, okay? The thing is like, just hit cancel, don't save it. Don't save.
No, you're just thorough.
Okay.
I've seen your tests.
Thank you, now I understand.